So I wanted to thank you all again for coming today, and especially for staying all the way to the very end, and especially for those of you who joined us last night for the networking dinner. I know it's sort of a marathon that we put you through, many, many hours together, many, many hours talking and thinking about work, so we're glad that you're still here today. We're quite invested in this next panel and in the issue more generally, and we hope that it's going to raise a series of questions and concerns and activities that we can continue to collaborate on now and in the coming years, because for us, anyways, this is just the beginning of work that we want to do. We've been talking about holding a panel on debt at Humanists at Work for years. It was actually something I thought about when we first initiated this program, and I was holding it for the right place. So I worked on space in my dissertation, so I'm always thinking about what are the right spaces to have certain kinds of conversations, and for me, I mean, I was hoping to have it in Santa Cruz, and that's because that's where I do my work, and there's a lot of conversations that happen there, but to be honest, Silicon Valley feels like the perfect space to have a conversation about debt. So I'm glad it's happening here. Before I hand this conversation over to our moderators, I wanted to share a bit about how it came to be. So I'm a humanities PhD and I am in debt. I'm in six-figure debt. And there are many reasons why this is, and I will admit that the guilt and shame of being in debt encourages me to share a long list of conditions and personal choices that led me to this place. And that's actually why I'm reading the remarks, is because I could just go off. And I don't want to go off, I want to be focused. And I'm resisting it because I recognize the impulse to do this is out of a sense of shame and certainly insecurity about whether I made the right choices, and also an embarrassment and a frustration that I feel like my choices were already seriously flawed before I even had the chance to choose. So some of my debt is undergraduate debt, for sure. But a majority of my debt was accrued while in graduate school at Santa Cruz, a not inexpensive place to live, I would add. And I will state that I was as supported materially by my advisors at Santa Cruz as anyone, and probably even more so. I was actually really well-funded and supported by my advisors, and I'm thankful for that. And yet, those summer research trips to Italy were not entirely funded. The conferences weren't entirely funded. I took out loans to live. And it was to live at a level to which I'd become accustomed, because I had worked prior to grad school. So I worked in government and had a series of networks and connections and responsibilities that just needed more than $1,700 a month. And clearly my family support, while rich emotionally, was meager financially. So that just wasn't an option for me. So my mom, I remember at the time, encouraged me to take out or to go get another job. And I was like, but you just have a master's. Like, you don't understand what it is to be a PhD student, right? You can't do everything. Of course, like, I hear these stories about you guys doing all of these things, and it's like, maybe I should have chosen differently. But at the time, it was like, I was there to do research and to be very focused, and that was my choice. And I would do it again, probably with fewer loans, but I would do it again. So as I finished graduate school with a newborn in my immediate future, I was very realistic about the kinds of professional opportunities that I could pursue and those that I could not. So I could not support a family by adjuncting, for example, with the hope of landing a tenure track job 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 years down the road. Well, if ever, right? I also could not pursue just any kind of administrative position in a for-profit company, for example. My loan payments would need that I would need to make a certain amount of money, and even if I was aggressive to the point of obtaining one of these administrative positions, it would need to be a very high-paying one, and I just think that would be unrealistic, to be quite honest, for my first or 2 years out. So the other thing is that I knew I needed a position that would come with a government-supported loan program. So here I'm gonna get very specific, and this played into how I looked for jobs. I had a sort of equation in my life where it was like, I was the sole income earner for a family of three, where it was like income-based repayment plus federal loan forgiveness equals, and I still don't know what the equals is. I think it's something like staying afloat. So maybe we can talk about that today, like what's at the end of the equation. So the idea for this panel on debt, it grew out of my personal financial circumstances. Sorry, it's emotional talking about this. So I don't know if you guys will experience the same, but where my personal financial circumstances dictated the kinds of choices that I could make. You know, So in our videos, talked a lot about financial debt, but actually my interest in debt is much more than financial debt. And here, I was thinking about debt from my professional background in government service. And so when I was working in government, I was working on children's and families issues across the state. And I left this kind of work in order to pursue scholarship around publicness and art. And I think I had the idea that post-PhD I was gonna go work for a government arts organization, which seems just so ideal in this environment right now for a variety of reasons. I also come from parents who spent, and they still spend, most of their working lives as public servants. And so my parents weren't the ones to theorize this for me, but I think it was about their daily commitment to making something better. There was an ethos of wanting to contribute to something greater than oneself, and work was the primary way that they did this. I also grew up in a family of veterans, and so above all, being honorable was very crucial to our family identity. And at least for my family, the men who served didn't do so out of some kind of blind commitment to the nation state or waving the flag. For my grandfather and father, it was a way of getting out of certain kind of personal circumstances. And my grandfather lied at 15 so he could essentially escape an orphanage and go into the military as a way out. It was the idea for the men who served that sometimes for the greater good, it requires personal sacrifice. And I had a hard time with this as a teenager, wearing the upside down flag on my backpack as a way to kind of like antagonize my father, but also as a kind of way of resisting and asking questions. I've come to realize as I've gotten older though that my family at least honor, which I understand is both personal honor and a sort of national honor and public good are intertwined. And this is my family story and I don't want to spend too long kind of going into it. But I share this story because as a humanities student, as a scholar, and as an administrator, I think about my work as coming from a sense of debt to particular communities and ideas to whom I feel a sense of honor. And that's come out a lot today. And so I just want to raise that these are other issues to talk about. We can certainly talk about financial debt and all of that, but I think that we can think about debt in a much more capacious way, and that this conversation really grew out of an interest to do that as well. We have a debt to the communities that we study and are responsible to, and probably more importantly, to those communities beyond and other than ourselves. And so our Humanists at Work community, which I imagine broadly to include any humanities PhD student and alumni interested in the future of work in a collective way, is an underserved one, at least in my opinion. So our institutions are beginning to work on readying this, but in comparison to our peers, I would argue, and especially when you hit the streets looking for work post-PhD, there's much that we're working without. And yet we're also an elite community. And it might feel like everybody we know has a PhD. That's not actually the case. In some ways, we're the 1%. And for this reason, I think it's especially important that we think, talk, and work on debt in ways that go beyond ourselves. And so today's conversation represents just the first step for us. I'd like to introduce our moderators for the panel, who will talk a little bit about how this series came to be and the kind of funky structure of it. So I'd like to introduce Shane Breitenstein and Anirban Gupta Nagam, who are both ABD in Visual Studies at UC Irvine and graduate student researchers at UCHRI. Shane is working on a project on the visual culture of childhood, media policy, and consumer activism. And Anirban is currently at work on a project at the intersections of media and environmental studies. And both have been interested in the subject for quite a while and were really formative in terms of setting this panel up. So I'll hand it over to you guys.
Thank you guys. And again, I'll reinforce what Kelly said. We appreciate everybody who has stuck with us the rest of the day. We're really looking forward to have this actually be a candid conversation. So to give you a sense of what Candid Conversations is, it's a type of programming that Humanists at Work has utilized multiple times. And the idea behind it is that it brings an opportunity for faculty, graduate students, and university staff to engage in a very sincere and candid dialogue. Particularly, I think this is important around the question of debt, as Kelly has already suggested. There's a lot of shame and embarrassment that surround it, and our institution doesn't do a whole lot of talking about how to ameliorate those problems. So we're really looking forward to kind of opening up the field today and really allowing people to have a space to speak openly about these things. To give you a sense of how this panel was actually constructed in the process, the way Candid Conversations operates is before the panelists are actually chosen, we reach out to academics and other people involved in the field and ask them to make a very short video, kind of a chain letter type video. So one person will produce a video, at which point they send it to the second participant, and their job is to kind of respond in dialogue to that. So we actually, if you turn around and look on the screen, we asked four people who work in and out of the UC system, some professors and some more involved with administration, to respond to two questions, which I will read to you now. The first question was, how and why is it important to think about debt in relationship to PhD student training, professionalization, and post-dissertation careers? So this question was really addressing what Kelly also suggested is the kind of financialization of debt, which is really the dominant form the conversation takes. But we also want to talk about debt again in a kind of expanded field. So we also asked panelists to respond to a much larger question, which is, how do you think humanities scholarship might speak to debt, not only as a financial issue, but also one that is related to broader questions of community and knowledge sharing? Since being in debt is an intensely collective experience, how can humanities scholarship help conceptualize new kinds of graduate student communities that, even as they share knowledge and expertise, also help articulate indebtedness as a social rather than individual issue? So if you didn't have a chance to look at the four videos, we definitely encourage you to go home and do that after our panel today. They're all on our website. And again, after those videos were produced, we distributed them to all of our panelists who graciously agreed to participate as kind of the background for what we're calling their provocations today. So what you'll see for the rest of the day is each panelist is going to talk to you for about 5 to 7 minutes, either about their personal relationship to debt, their scholarly relationship to debt, their relationship to debt and community organizing. And at that point in time, we will open up the floor to questions from the audience. And I'd like to stress that we're really excited about opening up the floor to questions from the audience, again, because this is such a deeply personal issue, a deeply private issue, and we're really trying to pull that out of the closet today. So what I'd like to do now is just go ahead and briefly introduce all our panelists, and at which point I will turn it over. So first we have Jennifer McSpadden, and she is an ABD candidate at the University of California, Davis, I believe studying French literature and critical theory. Second, we have Jessica Beard, who is a PhD graduate from UC Santa Cruz, and she currently is higher education project organizer for the American Federation of Teachers. So we have someone who is actually actively involved with community organizing and questions of labor. Third, we have Allison Perlman, who's assistant professor in the Departments of History and Film and Media Studies at University of California, Irvine. And then finally, we have Joshua Anderson, who is also a graduate student at University of California, Berkeley in the English Department. So with no further notice, we welcome our panelists and we will begin.
I don't know if this is on. It's not. What do I do?
Now it's on. So hi, so you know my name is Jennifer, and as Shane has already introduced, I am a PhD ABD at UC Davis in French Literature and Critical Theory. I've also chosen to write down my thoughts because I have quite a bit to say about student loans, so bear with me because I might be a little bit less organized than some of our other panelists. So I first wanted to give you a little bit of background about my student loan experiences, and I wanted to be very brutally honest with you. I started taking out student loans at the age of 17 when I started my undergraduate career, and I started with a private loan with Wells Fargo. Bad choice, don't do that. that one I've been paying on for the past 4 years, so that's almost gone. But it has definitely limited what I can do with my degree, and it has definitely affected my progress on my dissertation. The bulk of my loans, though, as Kelly has expressed in her experience, have come from my graduate studies, right? So I now owe just about $100,000, and I am currently delinquent because of my financial situation. So just to let you know a little bit about that. I wanted to start out by talking about civic activism and civic engagement amongst graduate students, right? So universities across the US, and particularly in California, have historically been figured as the loci of political, cultural, and civic engagement, right? From the civil rights era to the Vietnam War era, and now to present day, with our protests and our strikes and our teach-ins that have been aimed at challenging our rapidly increasing tuition and the resulting limitations to the financial accessibility of graduate studies. I would like to propose today that these limitations to our accessibility and our indebtedness should be viewed as a call to arms and a call to action amongst graduate students and amongst our departments, I would hope. But first, let's take a look at some staggering statistics. So according to the Federal Education Budget Project at New America, approximately 40% of the $1 trillion in student loan debt in the United States were used to finance graduate and professional degrees, and yet, graduate students only comprise 16% of the entire student population in this country, right? So how can we be carrying so much of this debt? This disparity becomes even clearer when you examine the average debt load of undergrads, which has now hit a high of $30,000, compared with that of grad students. So about one quarter of graduate students will take out $100,000 during their graduate careers, and one in 10 will take out about $150,000, right? And yet, as we all know, only a scandalously small percentage of PhDs are able to lock down that elusive tenure-track job, which more often than not is still not even lucrative enough to pay off those debts and to save the financially weary PhD from a lifetime of indebtedness and debt servitude. This indebtedness, as I said, serves as a call to arms, a call to action. And grad students have successfully applied pressure to administrations to oust corrupt administrators and chancellors, as in the example of UC Davis, right? Took us about 5 years, but we got Katagi out of there. And I believe that this can translate to a much larger scale and to affect change in the student loan system. So consider also your own financial well-being while in graduate school. Personally, throughout my graduate career, I have felt overworked and underpaid, hovering just barely above the poverty line until I was finally forced to take on two extra jobs in order to be able to pay for that private student loan that I took out for my undergraduate studies because it entered repayment and I had no choice, right? My experience, my debt experience has conditioned so much of my graduate life, including my need to work multiple jobs and the timely completion of my dissertation. Or not. My experience, I believe, has been shared by many others, and throughout my conversations with my colleagues at UCD, I've discovered that our being in common, although a little theoretical, is an overwhelming sense of exploitation, not only as graduate student instructors, but as borrowers, because we're left with very few options outside of student loans to pay for our living expenses and fees that are not covered by university funding, fee remissions, and our meager teaching stipends. I mean, in Davis, the cost of living alone, if you look at our rental rates, it's $1,500 to $2,000 a month, and graduate student instructors only get paid about $2,000 a month. Yeah. But despite these shared experiences and frustrations, I found that it's been difficult for graduate students as a community to affect change to the student loan system. And I'm taking here as my basis for community Jean-Luc Nancy's conception of community from the inaugurative community. And he considers this in terms of our being in common and communication. Our being in common as graduate students, according to Nancy's conception, is neither related to a communal or social bond, nor to the act of coming together or group formation, because this is something that we clearly do already, right? We're doing it now. Nor is it related to the act, nor to the communion of singularities, or in this case, a communion of indebtedness. In the place of a communion of individual student loan debt experiences, there is, in Nancy's conception, communication. This is the most important element, or that utopian social form that Professor McClanahan mentioned in her video. The basis of community in this sense, then, is consequently not the fusion or the union of a group through a communal bond, but a reciprocal revelation of singularities, the singularity of both the individual and of encounters and events. So with this in mind, what can we do? What can we do? I believe that graduate students can utilize and benefit from this process of exposition, revelation, sharing, and communication to, first of all, have very open and honest conversations with prospective graduate students about their financial futures and about what their living expenses are going to be like from day to day, what they're actually going to be paid, be able to pay for with the money that they are given by the university. And keeping in mind that with most TA ships comes the fact that you cannot hold a job outside of the university. Okay. And that makes it very difficult for us to survive from day to day. I would also propose that we take that strike culture that we are so used to here at the University of California and push for reforms. And the reforms that I would like to mention, and I hope that we can discuss this later on, would be potentially maybe merit-based criteria for student loans, because if we can't get rid of them altogether, we can at least improve them now. Setting limits on the loan amounts that we can get, because as graduate students, we can get however much money we want. They're gonna keep giving it to you, right? So I would like, you know, for us to have limits on that. And also the potential to have incentives for performing well in your program, perhaps having some sort of student loan forgiveness at some point because you performed well. So these are some of the ideas that I would like to discuss with you today. And please, please ask me any question you want about student loans. I have so much to share. Okay, that's what I have.
So I have very prepared remarks as well, because I have endless things to say about student debt. I'm also a six-figure debt holder. I almost didn't finish my PhD because I did not know why I was finishing my PhD for a minute. But I come from a working class background. I'm the first person in my family to go to college, so I was going to be the first person in my family to get a PhD. No matter what, that might seem crazy. It seems crazy to me now. But I'm just going to read from this because that's what I'm going to do. So what I'd like to offer today is a perspective on why those of us go into monetary and psychic debt for graduate degrees in the humanities, and how that is connected to our continued ability to settle for precarious and demoralizing working conditions as adjunct faculty. I'm a union organizer, so here I go. I'd like to suggest it has a lot to do with social class and misplaced hopes of upward mobility. I'd also like to echo the video contributors' assertions that community and solidarity in practice and not just in theory are crucial to any power that we're going to build to resist the debt incurred by the abhorrent learning and working conditions the majority of our colleagues face or will face as students and contingent workers. So my story goes like this. It was 2012 when the dream of class mobility dissolved for me, and the stark reality of ABT back to EBT, because that's where I come from, set in. You know, stuck in the dissertation phase for what seemed like forever, I was a graduate student instructor at UCSC and a lecturer at San Francisco State. I was an apprentice freeway flyer. I also assisted students at a high school after school program, waited tables, taught a Stanford High School summer program, was a GSR for the UCSC IHR, and worked for an art moving company. I hustled, but I also won fellowships, did research, gave papers, collaborated with scholars in my field, and put on conferences. When I wasn't working a job or working on a project, I was writing a dissertation, and when I wasn't doing any of these things, I was tired, angry, and scared that I was broke and in debt with no prospects in a dead-end career I hadn't even started yet. My dad, a man who worked manual labor his whole life, would ask me all the time, like, why are you doing this? Like, what are you doing? I was motivated by something my writing partner and most solid graduate school comrade, Anne, and I called the carrot. Looking back at the carrot, I realized how tricky and manipulative it was. It eluded my own sense of class consciousness as a first-generation college student, as well as lifelong critiques of bosses, conformity, and workers' exploitation. It told me all the time that if I just could finish this chapter, maybe then I'd get the competitive fellowship, finish my dissertation, and maybe then, after almost a decade of teaching and writing, I could get a full-time job and maybe join the middle class. The carrot was training me to be the best exploited worker I could be, because it was telling me I wasn't working for anyone but myself and therefore could not be exploited. I was working so hard for worthy causes, doing things like producing knowledge and educating others. I was doing it out of love. There was no boss in this equation, just the broken down idea that if you work real hard, you'll be successful. This carrot was not only draining me monetarily by keeping me stuck in low-paying gig jobs, it was draining me psychologically by telling me to do it out of my commitment to a profession that had no commitment to me. So sadly, this UC Santa Cruz student of critical theory was trained to analyze and critique power anywhere but in my own occupation, because I didn't see myself as a worker. But then I got organized. 2 weeks after I filed my dissertation, I was teaching at the San Francisco Art Institute, and adjunct faculty there started to form a union. A light switch turned on inside of me, and for the last 3 years, building faculty power in higher education has gone from a volunteer passion to a full-time job. I work collaboratively with faculty to help them build solidarity, urgency, and strategy in their fight for fair wages and working conditions. I help them to see that they are all workers, and I work to give them hope that their collective power will make change. But I ask myself all the time, what if this didn't have to be such a late intervention? What if the academy could actually use its theory to critique its practice and actively encourage its students to do so? I think we all know why this doesn't happen. But as higher education professionals, whether we are students, adjuncts, professors, directors, or organizers, we all have the ability to create this culture, create solidarity and power across our ranks, and take back our institutions for ourselves and our students. So I agree wholeheartedly with your call to arms. It's crucial that we talk about class, precarity, and equity, and to ask why we have these conversations about undergraduate education and not graduate education. It's crucial we create a culture of solidarity where you're not afraid to tell your advisor you have 3 jobs, not afraid to admit to your colleagues that you have debt despite these 3 jobs, and where it is okay to make it clear to anyone you want that you can't afford to wait years on the job market to find or not find a tenure track job. So as an organizer and a recovering academic, nothing would make me happier than grad student and lecturer caucuses or working groups, perhaps regionally organized, that could come together on each campus and make visible these issues. Groups like Strike Debt, the adjunct and grad student and undergrad workers that are all organizing right now. Big shout out to UC Berkeley undergraduate workers that are doing amazing work right now. Coming together to build power, they inspire great hope in me, and I hope we can keep talking about how we can join their collective energy to move forward.
I have a green light. Can you guys hear me? Excellent. A lot of what I have to say is going to be kind of a variation on the themes that have already been brought up. But before I do, I just want to make a few comments. First, I want to say thank you so much for including me in this event. This is my second Humanist at Work. As she mentioned, I'm a faculty member at UC Irvine, and every time I come to these sessions, I feel like I walk away with a better understanding of how I can be a more ethical advisor, mentor, and ally for my graduate students, and so I'm really just grateful for all of you for giving me this opportunity. Second, I want to thank Kelly, Anirban, and Shane for putting this panel together. I started graduate school in 1998, so I started my master's program, and this is the first time I've ever had a public conversation about debt, so I think this is somewhat remarkable, and I'm really grateful that we're doing this together. I want to tell you just a little bit about my own relationship to debt, and then I have 2 interrelated points that are my provocation for this conversation. So I paid down my debt. I've been out of graduate school for about 10 years, but when I left my PhD program, I had about $85,000 worth of debt. About $23,000 of that came from my undergraduate education. And very similar to, I think, many people in this room, I acquired a lot of debt in graduate school because I was single. I did not have a family who was able to help support me through school. I worked multiple jobs throughout graduate school, often 2 or 3 jobs a year, but at a certain point, you need to finish your dissertation. If you're an interdisciplinary program, as I was, you probably have to attend conferences in multiple fields, and you're lucky if your graduate program will support you partially for 1 conference. When you're on the market, you need to have nice-ish clothes, which are often you have not been wearing for a very long time. And the stipend that we receive, or I have received as a graduate student, often didn't cover my living expenses. So I have been living with debt for quite some time, and I am one of the lucky ones. You know, I've ended in a tenure track job. At this point in my life, I have a salary that allows me to pay my debt monthly, but it also means that I would probably never own a house. I often think I didn't get a house, I got a PhD, because the money that I might have been able to put away for a home is now going to my student loan
officers.
One of the things that was so helpful for me in watching the four videos, and I want to really underline how illuminating they are, is it helped me start acquiring the language to think about how I wanted to talk about student debt. And one of the things I thought was incredibly powerful about Chris Newfield's piece is the way that he talked about the endeavor that we're involved in as a public good that has been misinterpreted as a private good, right? That we're involved in a collective enterprise in some ways to inculcate good citizenship, to ask really important questions about what it means to be a person and how we ought to live, to educate future generations. And yet the way that we're approached as graduate students is that we're pursuing something for our own personal gain that has some potential lucrative value at the end of it, analogous to potentially people who go to law school. And that for him, this is a misinterpretation of the endeavor of higher education altogether. And I think we can think about the student debt crisis through this lens. And in many ways, student debt is directly related to the jobs crisis that in part is motivating so many of these conversations in the first place. And I want to tweak just a little bit one of the comments that was made on this morning's panel about supply and demand problem in higher education. And I think this is a narrative that we often tell, that there are more people seeking jobs than there are jobs, and so a potential solution is let's reduce the number of PhDs, let's have a better match between how many positions are available and how many people are credentialed for them. But as we all know, the demand for higher education has not gone down, right? Our campus at UC Irvine is going to be expanding to 40,000 students. I think most of the UC campuses are going to try to accommodate more undergrads. The Cal States are having to be more selective in the students that they're able to matriculate. So there's a tremendous need for people to teach in institutions of higher education. What there is not is an allocation of resources to allow professionalized, degreed individuals attain those jobs. And instead, we rely on adjuncts and grad students. So we rely on cheap, exploited labor, but not because there's an absence of a demand, but because we have misallocated resources. I think the same we could say about student loans, right? The reason why I took out loans was because I was not making enough money. If my stipend had been greater, if my institution had invested more in me, I would be so thrilled not to have student debt, right? It's something that anybody ever wants. And so this leads me to my first provocation, which is that we tend to think of debt as an individual failure, as something that's shameful, as something that we did wrong. And without a doubt, debt is something that is borne by the individual, right? It's one of the few forms of debt, student loans, that is not erased if you declare bankruptcy. But as I investigated, your heirs cannot inherit your debt. So it dies with you, luckily. But you can't, but you can get rid of it otherwise. But I think we need to start thinking about student loans as a societal failure. It's a social failure. It's a failure of the commons. It's a failure of our collective commitment to the civic good. And once we stop thinking about it as something that we did wrong and start recognizing it as a social problem that we collectively need to fix, then talking about our debt no longer seems so shameful. And so that's something that I just want to impart to everyone in here who has student debt, is that this is not something that you did that was wrong. You're living at a particular historical juncture in which the work that we do is not being appropriately valued and supported. Second short provocation is something that I have been thinking about a great deal, and again, these videos have helped me to find the language to articulate why it bothers me so much, and that is I have been frequently asked by my students if they should attend graduate school. Probably many of you who work with undergraduates have been asked the same thing, and the conventional wisdom is to tell undergraduates only go to graduate school if you don't have to get into debt, right? And part of that is this very ethical claim of if you go and get a PhD, there's a very strong chance that there will not be a job for you at the end, and so please do not start out your working life with a huge amount of debt. And I get that. But I also think that implicitly what's being said is only go to a graduate program that can provide you with a very comfortable funding package. In other words, only go to a private elite school. Or only go to graduate school if you come from personal wealth or if you have a partner or someone who can support you. And so what that produces potentially is an academic environment of people are either only trained at elite institutions or who only come predominantly from elite backgrounds. And I think it's not controversial to say that's not an academic environment that anyone really wants to teach in, and it's certainly not one that serves the needs of our society. And so I think we have to also think very critically about what is it that we're saying when we're telling people that debt is something that always ought to be avoided without recognizing the structural factors that lead them to get into debt in the first place.
Can you hear me?
Hello. As our introducers introduced us, my name is Joshua. I am a 38-year-old father of three. I'm currently around my sixth year up at UC Berkeley in the English department. Before I tell my story, just real quick, I'm going to talk about three things. I wrote some notes on what I learned as a padfolio. I wanted to apologize. I lost a contact, so I'm doing this weird winky thing, that's why. I wanted to start by thanking sincerely and personally Kellyanne Brown for helping me get out here tonight, or today. I'm going to be talking a little bit about language and about the anxiety around this odd binary between the personal and the social or the political or whatever you want to call it. And I think it's extremely important to acknowledge those personal relationships because Kelly understood the extreme conditions that I personally find myself under, which involve finding a way down here. Was very difficult for me, I'm only a little bit up the road. So I want to tell my story real quick, and I'm going to tell you why I feel a little bit like an outlier, but I'm also going to comment a little bit on how I think the ideology of debt does that to each of us. So I'm going to talk about language, I'm going to talk about debt as violence, and I'm going to talk about stakes. Okay, first my story. I come from Kansas, born and raised in a working class household, none of my brothers, nobody in my family, I'm going to college. Like I said, I've got three children, one of which I found out was on the way as I was driving out here with my family to come to school. Coming to California after living in Kansas was a huge risk. It wasn't, even though I had saved some money and I had received some money, did everything we all do, we click our heels, we do the hustle. If you've ever been a McNair student or like, you know, had to go to the Student Parent Center, you know the hustle. We all know the hustle. I am a biracial, working class guy. I don't really know my biological father, who just happened to call during that last. This fellow is riddled with mental health issues in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Similarly, one of the reasons if you saw me like jetting in and out of the last couple of sessions, it was because I was on the phone with social services where I spend at least two full days a month haggling for food stamps for myself and my partner and our three children. That's cashing the bus. I mean, that's just time on the ground in the waiting line. Right now, I've been lucky enough to get a summer gig, doing some editing and doing some teaching for a startup test prep school. But to be honest with you, this other idea that has crossed my path, an opportunity has crossed my path to do some bar backing in San Francisco sounds much more, well, it's actually much more lucrative. I've got babies to feed, I've got, I'm quite literally like at this moment where I need to take a break from school because it's too much. So I'm close to a breaking point. Breaking point can be defined a few different ways. What I want to comment on is the language. I want to do some like sort of meta comment on the language of the conversation if we're having a conversation. I'm going to talk about some things that trouble me. Forgive me if I go a little too long. I just got these crazy notes. First of all, I'm troubled a little bit. I think that the terms thinking about and conversations about are far too capacious. I think that's like saying we're all gonna get together and think about and talk about these things. And I think that we need to move to a register where we're saying what we're gonna say. And forgive me if I get like a little bit standoffish, a little bit angry. I'm gonna talk about that too from maybe a little bit more academic standpoint. Similarly, some I've heard these echoes of the make it work for you ideology here and there over the last 2 days. And I shook my head and I scoffed and I did all that stuff. There's a material set of conditions that is designed to keep a lot of people from making anything work for them, and that's all there is to it, and that's something we can't forget. But interestingly enough, I think the main point that,
that I've noticed, watching the videos and listening to everybody, is this weird sort of humming anxiety that surrounds everything. This anxiety that surrounds coming to Silicon Valley in the first place, from ideologues who tell us that we're selling out, if we're like looking for jobs somewhere or something like this, or the people who scoff at those ideologues, and the sort of pure idealism of what we do as educators in the humanities. So I think that's one of the reasons we have vague and capacious like verbs, like let's think about this and talk about this. I don't think we need to do that anymore. I think we need to say what we're here to say. Similarly, I think the main binary is that political or social versus the personal, and we all have opinions as to how we need to structure it. And we all have the vernacular and the training to be able to talk about structural violence on that register. But I think maybe also we need to think a little bit more about the personal. One of the emails that I received really bothered me because it mentioned debt as necessary for a sense of collegiality. And I know that we want to foster solidarity somehow. I know that we want to be like, hey, we're all in this together. But I think the ideology of debt also is profoundly atomizing and isolating. And that there's some way we need to find the words to articulate the relationship between this weird fact that we're all in the same boat, but we all have a different sort of narrative of pain, of suffering. Some of us have it a little easier, some of us have it a little harder. And that's the worst register to start from. It's not about comparing those things. Third of all, debt is violence. One of the videos mentioned debt as oppression. I think debt is a form of oppression, but it's a specific violence. It's something that is rendered upon people. It's sort of like done to people. And at the end of the day, a very simple matter. But what I wanted to talk about sort of in relation to my studies is I'm doing like mid-century young children's literature. I read a lot of Bonnie Klein. And a good, I think, formal analog for thinking about the sort of violence that debt like does to a subject is her idea of the paranoid schizoid position, which she articulates for very young children. She says, it's really simple actually. The paranoid schizoid position begins when there is a lack in front of that child, when it wants something, but that lack is interpreted as an attack. That's hence the paranoid, right? And of course, this sort of position pops up as we grow, when we see that there's not something there, and yet we feel as though that is an attack. The thing about the idea, what I guess I'm calling the ideology of debt, is that the paranoid part is we never know. Is it our fault? Is it lack? Are we being paranoid by being angry? When it's a lack and not an actual attack, I think it's an attack. Relatedly to my story, when I first showed up at the University of California, Berkeley, was during Occupy, and I was there in Oakland when they kicked everyone out of the Occupy encampment, new to California. I had actually just broken up with my ex-wife at the time. I was on Sproul Plaza, and I was badly beaten by the police. I am still actually, as of this moment, because the UC has the best lawyers in the world, in the middle of a class action lawsuit against the University of California, which I probably technically can't talk much about. But the point is at that moment, I was like, this is something I think happens a lot with street violence involving the police, brutality. And that's that the whole discourse is structured around individuals doing something bad, or individual departments maybe, or do we perceive this as the weight of the state? I had asked myself from the beginning, what did UC play in this? And that's why we're like waging this sort of legal battle. The point being that violence is wrapped up in my debt violence. There are distinctions to be made as to sort of the fronts that you have to fight various forms of violence. But because debt is a negativity, and debt is something that comprises us increasingly in like uber globalized, uber digitized, like uber monetized world, that debt is something that sits like deep inside of us, and that comprises us on some level. I think lastly, once the child gets through the paranoid schizoid, you get into the depressive position, which is like the sort of base position for all people as they grow up, and that involves guilt. Guilt is a form of debt, and it's sort of an iteration or an echo of like debt ideology, which is why we're all like, oh, is it my fault? It's not your fault. It's none of our faults. It is a fault. It is our fault in the sense that if we want to get specific about language, I'm glad you mentioned this word. We need to stop saying, I'm thinking about this, or blah, blah, blah. We need to say something like, this is a failure. This is our failure. This is a failure of the humanities. This is a failure of the university to protect the simple lives of the folks who labor for us and who we labor for. I think we need to find a specific word like that and use it. So lastly, the stakes. I'm actually a little bit appalled, a little bit surprised, that I haven't heard more talk about the stakes. I've heard talk about our stakes, about the sort of, let me back up a little bit. I asked myself this question, what is this? I was invited to come down here and talk, and I wasn't familiar with what was going on, so I got on the website and I looked around, and forgive me, or don't, is this white elites panicking and like fleeing the ship? Is this some sort of academic white flight? Like, what's happening here? Nobody's saying, go get a job, and nobody's outright saying, go get a job in Silicon Valley. Nobody's saying, do this until we fix things, but all these things are implied. I think until we realize the stakes of everyone who is involved, and I sometimes don't think we should make an undergraduate, graduate like distinction. I don't think we should make that big of a distinction as we sometimes do. Until we begin to register the lived reality, what happens to people in the paranoid schizoid position for whom this weird abstract but also very material forces of debt comes at us from all sides, including that institution through which we like wanted to change the world. I think until we can register, articulate the lived reality of non-traditional students, undocumented students, parents, students, women, queer, trans, indigenous, black folks, non-black people of color, low-income and homeless students, until we can talk about that on a different register, on a less like scared of talking about that register, then I don't think the conversation is going to move very far. At the end of the day, I think our anxiety is wrapped around somehow abandoning society if we're going to come down to Silicon Valley and start teaching for SAT prep or whatever. Like, we've abandoned our ethical like principles or what have you. And I think that maybe perhaps we need to start thinking about not abandoning those folks that are in the university with us, but whose like positionality is vastly different. And that's, I'm sorry, that's all I have to say.
So this is maybe more just a kind of reaction to what I was hearing, which begins with a sort of acknowledgement that I think Shane Kelly and everyone else would admit that the panel itself puts us in a sort of death to you, because to get the conversation started and to actually have a frank debate about this was a massive problem, just to kind of figure out who would be willing to voice the question. I'm not going to repeat that. So I was thinking while listening to you, I was thinking somewhere of, there's a depth syllabus up on the website, on the UCHRI website, and one of the readings there is Fred Moten and Stefano Harney, and I was thinking there of, there's a moment in the book where they say that a student is a bad debtor because she studies. And I wanted to throw that out there as something where studying is not the university, but it's a different form of collectivity. And they're trying to get it maybe some way where debt doesn't haunt you, but you can haunt it back. And I'm sort of interested in throwing this out, and not necessarily as a question, as a comment, if you want to respond to it, mainly because I think between Jean-Luc Nancy, Melanie Klein, and all the other deep insights about contemporary historical structural violence, I don't want to foreclose the possibility of study as a way to address the question of debt and pose this distinction between the humanities and some form of knowledge on the one hand and finance, privatization, etc. on the other. And that's it. I mean, as someone who is kind of maniacally obsessed by reading. I want to see or ask you if you want to speak to what forms of knowledge or other forms of collective study inside or outside the university persist, which acknowledge indebtedness and then doesn't let that become a kind of end point, and you don't curl up in the depressive position.
I suppose I'll venture a very brief response and then I'll hand it over. But I like this idea that the student is a bad debtor because she studies, right? I personally, my dissertation is very focused and anchored in critical theory, right? And critical theory has really provided me with the tools to be able to analyze the power structures that are imposed upon me as a graduate student, as a teacher, as a student who doesn't have financial means to pay for their studies. And because of this, I believe that it makes me question more the structures of, let's say, the student loan system. And because of this, I'm going to question why I should be paying back. Why should I be paying back this money when I was not given what I was promised with my degree? Right, so it leads to this fundamental dissatisfaction. And at this point, you know, being delinquent in my loans, I believe that it's starting to transition to a point where I may choose just not to pay them back at all, because I feel like there's something fundamentally wrong with the system. And there's something fundamentally wrong with a system that keeps pushing these tuition rates higher and higher, and yet they expect us to live on such a meager wage. It's just not possible, and it produces such stress that it actually puts a strain on our work. And it puts limitations on the types of knowledge that we can produce. It puts limitations on the types of conferences that we can go and present at, because we just don't have the money to make it from conference to conference. I don't know where else I was going to go with that. I think Jessica was wanting to say a little something as well.
So when I heard that question, the first thing I thought of was, you know, my job is an entry-level job, right? I'm an organizer. You can do that with a college degree in most unions. Mm-hmm. But I think what makes me an effective organizer in higher education is the fact that I've studied, and I know how to talk to people who study all the time, and I know how to motivate them in a way and help them to see like what I was trying to describe in my talk, which is like, yeah, we all talk about this stuff in theory, but we do not practice it. We do not practice it. We can talk about our students being, you know, having certain forms of oppression, but we cannot talk about the fact that, you know, we can't get our grading done because we had to work two other jobs, or we can't be as generous to our students because we have to do all these other things. So I feel like, because I question sometimes why I did, you know, what is good about what I did? Why did I do that? But I think honestly, if I, you know, keep going with this part, you know, this career, I feel like it'll make me really effective at being a rabble-riser of academics, which is not an easy thing to do, as you know, right? Like getting folks excited and politically active is not an easy thing to do. So I think it is about, you know, the language and being able to, you know, get people to feel weird about the fact that they read about stuff but don't look at themselves in that same way.
So you're wondering about study as like a sort of a term for a mode of like collectivity, essentially. Study is perhaps something that might exceed the institutional or material constrictions. And I was thinking about it. I'm trying to think about this very personally. Because I feel like I have two modes. And the second mode has been off for a long time. The first mode is survival mode. And that means I knew coming down here that three checks were coming out of my bank account and that two checks were going in. I wasn't sure when, at what point, you know, midnight. I woke up at 3, wasn't in there. That was the UC check. Thanks, guys. But I only mention that because I think I think that there's like a terminus, right? Whether it's perceived or whether it's real, whether it's material, actual, or someplace where we lose our minds. Because I know half a dozen folks right now who are like incredibly medicated because of this problem. And I have to get to that point. But the second mode is like ethical, political. Like I want to go out there. When I do this, it's May Day. I'm in Silicon Valley on May Day. Feels weird, honestly. I think, like, that's one of the things we need to, like, equally register for each other is where we are in that spectrum of modes between surviving or able to do something. Now, as to the question of whether or not we study, or how we might, like, maintain some sort of solidarity through study, I don't know. I mean, I personally always tote around like some, you know, stupid highfalutin text to read if I have 15 minutes or what have you. And I know that it's important to keep doing it. Like if I have to take a leave of absence or if I get kicked out, I'm gonna keep doing it. But I don't know what that means politically because I'm still trying to, when I get home, it's like the dice have been rolled, I'll have to read them and then go on with the rest of the week. So yeah, there's gonna be a lot of I don't know, forgive me.